Okay, use the lights. Almost in the sun, yeah.
Yeah, I can't quite see him from the record.
Yeah, but... yeah, he's right up in it. Good way above us, sadly.
Sorry.
Little bit of a push onto the right wing there, just a tiny bit.
Just start coming gently right.
Yeah.
Don't go too hard for the moment. Keep it gentle.
As a bird, as a clue.
Yep. Okay, tighten it a bit more in now. Just try and hold this turn as constant as you can.
Yep.
This is what is often referred to as scratching away.
Yeah, yeah.
Imagine doing this in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, indeed.
You've got low in the middle of a cross country.
Yeah.
You'd already have your field selected by this point.
Yeah, indeed.
And you know if the thermal doesn't work, you're going to be in it.
Yeah. Yeah, so we're scraping around here at 800 odd feet, aren't we?
Yeah. I've done it lower than this as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, on a cross country with the thermal down to about 500 feet. If I can't get away from that, then
yeah.
So one of the things you'd be doing while you were thermaling is you'd be watching your field and making sure that you're always in a position every time you come around the corner that you can get into that field.
Yeah,
if
sure.
You need to. As soon as it starts to look like you're getting in a position where you can't, then you're committed to the field.
Yeah.
So in our case, we're doing it for lateral.
Yeah.
We're a bit low. At the moment, we know if we need to, we can either take
I can sneak in straight ahead of me there, can't I? Or I guess possibly if I were further round, I could do 3-4 as well.
Yeah.
He's just up above us there now, look. Literally all we've done is gone nowhere height wise, isn't it, so far?
Yeah, it's not as bad as
it's
going
down, better than down. Another K13 straight ahead over there.
Sometimes you just have to persevere with this in the
Yeah, just
better.
Wait that it starts to bubble up again under you or something.
Pushed
on the left there, that side.
One recommendation I say about thermaling.
Yeah.
So quite often you'll be in a thermal and you'll feel like, oh, it's pushed up under the left wing, I wonder if it's there.
Yeah.
Reversing the turning direction always never works.
Right, yeah. I suppose the time you spend doing that sends you quite a distance away, isn't it?
Yeah, unless you are really, really sure that the thermal is to the left of you, don't reverse the direction.
Yeah.
because okay. you're going to fall out of it.
That's a good tip.
Again, like I was doing very similar to this in the Junior Nationals in August, out in Norfolk.
Yeah.
Thermally, a bit lower than this, about 500 feet above the field. And it was sort of barely working. There's actually two of us. There's me, being another guy, both at 500 feet with the same field select. trying to
just
scratch away.
Hoping it was going to happen.
Yeah, we persevered. We're probably at 500 feet for about half an hour, 40 minutes.
Really?
Which is exhausting.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it did start to work and we climbed away and we both got back to the airfield.
Oh, nice.
And we were only about halfway around a 250k
task. Oh crikey.
So there's still quite a bit of distance
to go.
You have
a bit to go, yeah.
But it just proves that persevering is worth it.
Yeah, yeah.
Got the
Todd's coming up, yeah, I see him, and the 13 next to him coming towards us. I think maybe he fancies trying out a really exciting thermal that's going to no feet.
It's going to get more exciting if he comes through.
It is, exactly. So I'm just thinking, saying that he's 100 feet below us, isn't he? So he might just be going in.
It is actually starting to get a bit.
It is getting a tiny bit, isn't it?
So let's just persevere with this and we might be lucky and get away. It's actually practicing this kind of soaring that wins or loses you competition.
Sure.
Because everyone can fly a perfectly round, well-formed thermal.
Yeah,
if it's an
awkward lumpy one, yeah.
We've gone up 100 feet.
Yep. Gained something there. We're still not really drifting anywhere particular, are we? Because there's not a lot of wind, so we're pretty much holding station.
Yeah, we're pretty much all right. The other thing you would be doing, if you were flying a higher performance glider and I was cross country, I would have already dumped my water by this point.
Right, yeah, of course.
Because if you're not climbing away with water on board, then you might as well make yourself lighter and give yourself more chance.
Yeah, that's it.
It also means you've already got rid of your water because you don't want it on board if you're outlanding.
Sure.
And if I'm below,
does that take time? How long does it take to dump that if you've got a lot of water ballast?
It depends on the glider. The flight manual will give you times. The glider I fly, the SW19, the flight manual quotes 2 minutes from full to empty.
Yeah, so it's considerable then in terms of what can happen inside of 2 minutes.
Yeah, flying a Discus 2 in Australia, which can carry about 250 litres of water.
Right.
And that quotes about 8 minutes for almost.
Blimey. Yeah.
So you've got to take that sort of thing into consideration if you're carrying water. And the other thing I would do, if I get below 700 feet, I put my undercarriage down.
Yeah, yeah.
And I keep firmly with the undercarriage down and I don't raise it again until I'm above 1,000 feet. And that's not like a BGA recommended thing or anything, that's just your
personal.
I've developed to try and keep myself safe. There we go, that's
okay, I've turned in a bit sharper there when I heard that. That was nice.
Yeah, these sorts of things like 500 foot being my lower limit. Mm. Dumping the water when I'm below 1,000.
Yeah.
I'm thermaling and putting the gear down below 700. They're all just things.
They're just your personal, your common sense, as it were,
exactly,
approach.
But
yeah.
They're hard and fast rules they stick to across country. I don't think, I'll leave the water on a bit more longer just in case. I dump it. If I'm going below 1,000, I dump it. So I'm not sort of messing around trying to make a tricky field landing with 100 litres of water in the wings. And everyone has different sets of limits, but when you're going across country, it's worth setting yourself some and knowing what they are and sticking to them.
Yeah, indeed. Come on. So if I straighten up a little bit in terms of, and then I'll get back into it there.
There we go.
Into better.
I'd probably trim yourself back if I do it.
So. Yeah. I'm probably flying a little fast, aren't I?
Hopefully this will gradually get better as we climb as well.
Yeah.
Thermal fusioning too.
Do they tend to sort of spread the column, kind of spread wider as it goes higher?
Yeah, they're sort of funnel shaped with just like a tornado.
Yeah, that kind of shape.
And the wider bit at the top.
Yeah.
But also, if you imagine, the speed at which the air rises essentially depends on the difference in temperature between the rising air and the air around it. As this rising air is rising, the air around it is getting cooler, so the speed at which starts to get higher. Obviously the air rising air starts to lose temperature as well, but generally at a slower pace
the differential is actually higher, isn't it, then? Yeah, we've got some height on there, haven't we?
Gone from only maintaining height.
Yeah, exactly. Again, it feels like it's just getting away downwind from me slightly, so I'm going to try just over this way a little bit.
Okay. Just watch that rudder really.
Yes. The tendency to get kind of locked into it when I'm in the turn for a long time there.
Visibility is just as awful as it was earlier.
Hazy and horrid, isn't it?
Yeah, I reckon the air pressure is probably increasing.
Yeah.
This
just squishing all that haze down onto us.
Yeah, exactly. That's also would explain why it's a lot less cloudy than earlier.
Yeah.
What's happening in a thermal is the moisture is getting carried up and then it's reaching a dew point, at which point the moisture is condensing into a cloud. But if the inversion gets low enough, that the temperature no longer gets to as low as the dew point until after it's gone through the inversion.
Got you.
The lift can still form perfectly well, but the clouds won't form.
Yeah.
Because the moisture is going to hit the inversion and just go sideways. It's never actually going to condense.
Got you.
So that's why you sometimes get blue soaring moves.
Yeah.
Blue days are a lot trickier to fly because you can't just look at the clouds, you have to really know what on the ground is triggering the lift.
Got you, and you're trying to extrapolate that plus whatever the wind direction is. And
exactly.
Yeah.
And it's certainly doable. I mean, like the one day we got on the Junior Nationals in August, that was one of the bluest days I've ever seen.
Really?
There was literally not a single cloud in the entire sky. But we still got about 20 of the 50 people in the grid around 250 kilometers per hour.
Wow.
So it's certainly doable.
Yeah.
It's just very difficult. We're doing nicely anyway.
We're getting some height on there.
Shows the hard work pays off.
Yes, that's it. Yeah, stick at it and you get there. There, it's not a lot by the sounds of it, but on the basis of what's happened so far, it's been working its way this way, so I'm just sort of following it.
Yeah.
Just on guesswork rather than anything else.
Yeah. So just thinking about ground phases might actually trigger them.
Yeah.
Well, essentially what you're looking for is you're looking for areas that are going to heat up more than the areas around them.
Yeah.
That's going to mean you get an area where the air heats up more than the air around it, and that's what they call it thermal.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how hot it is, if all of the air is the same temperature, basically.
Yeah.
And it won't rise.
So the darker coloured stuff, I suppose,
yeah,
for
exactly.
a start, is going to be something.
Exactly.
I mean, built up area, you know, buildings and stuff like that, is that
absolutely.
Significant enough
absolutely,
as a,
yeah.
an object?
For example, Alton, just over there.
Yeah.
They're probably getting, if we were brave enough to go that far.
Yeah.
This time, then I imagine there'd be lift over Alton.
Yeah.
Towns and cities are quite good at generating lift, not just because they've got a dark area, but they've got other things to raise the air temperature as well.
Sure,
like
yeah.
cars and humans and houses.
Yeah, just other stuff that's doing it.
Yeah, that'll heat up the air, just the same as the sun does.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's the sun that heated up the air or not. If you get an area that's hotter, it'll
yeah,
still
yeah,
rise.
Yeah, that's fair enough, I guess, isn't it? Yeah, rising air is rising air, so...
Yeah. So, yeah, towns are often good. Motorways are good, especially if there's a traffic jam. Find a traffic jam on the motorway.
Yeah.
All the cars still with their engines running.
Yeah.
Almost certainly get some lift over that. Possibly the best thing you can possibly look for, not at this time of year, but later in the year, is fields being harvested.
Right.
What happens is the crop stores loads of energy from the sun.
Yeah.
Throughout the year, and then when they go and cut the crop actually releases some of that energy into the air, and it actually raises the temperature
wow, okay.
of the air above the field.
Oh.
And it sounds like it should be insignificant, but it's really not.
Yeah,
you actually some of the best thermals of the day above fields where you've
yeah.
see these combine harvesters going up and down.
Actually, yeah, I know. Obviously, I'm not familiar with it from a crop perspective, but I know you know if you cut long grass on a hot day, and the heat that builds up in the cut grass itself is
yeah.
you know is pretty significant. So yeah, I can see how that would then be.
Yeah, releasing
heat as well.
If there's any instability in the air at all, and you find a field that's being harvested, you'll get a lift over it pretty much. It's one
yeah.
of the most reliable sources of lifts I can know. The only problem is if you're low down, and I've spoken to several different people this has happened to.
Yeah.
They've been getting low, about to land out, and they found a combine harvester that's cutting a field. And
right.
And they started thermaling over it. And then the guy in the combine harvester's gone, oh look, there's an aircraft circle.
And he stops.
I'll stop and have a look. And then he stops, and he stops
like,
producing
no.
a lift of keeping you up.
No, that's funny.
Power stations are good as well.
Yeah.
Of course, you can see why they would be.
Yeah, yeah, indeed. Lots of waste heat coming off.
And we don't put any airspace around our power stations in this country, so
right, yeah.
there's nothing stopping you from thermaling over them. In the US, for example, you can't do that because they've got
airspace. Yeah, I seem to remember seeing a story of somebody getting their collar felt quite substantially in the States for working over the top of a power station.
Yeah. Yeah, I can believe that. Water is really bad, but the water reflects all the energy
yeah.
instead of absorbing it. So you don't want to try and thermalize the water.
Oh.
Obviously, the material on the ground makes a difference as well, not just
yeah.
So things like tarmac are better at absorbing energy than the crop is. Not so much in this area, but if you find like mines or quarries, the stone absorbs the energy quite well.
Yeah.
So they're often quite good.
It's getting quite hazy up here now, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know whether that's the same glider that was with us a while ago down there.
Should
but
be.
We've done a lot better if it is.
Yeah. Let's come around there with this. Underneath us there now.
true.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Getting up to 3,000 feet is a lot more satisfying when you've had the work effort.
Yes, yeah, if you just whoosh up there for no apparent reason, yeah. It's a bit sinky and nasty, just wait a second there. Kind of directly above us.
Yeah.
There's a cloud sort of directly above us. I don't know if I'd be better off scooting in further under it if I come a little bit east on the, sorry, a bit west rather on the next turn.
I was worried a bit more about what the actual lift itself is
just
doing.
Just what it feels like.
Like if you pay attention to what direction you're pointing when the lift does different things.
Yeah.
You might start to find trends. For example, you might find every time I'm at the north end of the circle, I'm getting more lift.
Yeah.
And every time I'm at the south end of the circle, I'm getting less.
In which case,
you're going to move north.
I can hear it trending a bit there, so I'm going to come back. Turns left as well, doesn't it? So that's
yep.
We're going right all the way up there. This is where I find it like a screw thread, and left goes down, and the right goes up.
Yep.
Yeah, I was just saying I felt a little bit of a push on the left side, but I'm going to go around and see if it was anything. But not much there. In that case, it seems we started over there, it wasn't so bad, so I'm going to just take a guess. Try and push on a little bit quicker to get myself somewhere different. of those guys seem to think they have something.
Yeah.
So let's take the group mentality and see if I can find something over the top of those guys. Now I presume that there's nothing. Okay, I'm feeling a bit pushed there. Yeah. There we go.
Yeah, we're well above.
We're well above, aren't we? So there's no particular worry about that. I'm going to head into a little bit more. I've got another off nose over there.
That looks like an artist.
Something shiny. I kind of went past it, so I'm just going to try and get back to it again.
Thing to be aware of with the big shiny high performance thing,
yeah,
is the pilots flying them tend to be racing.
Yeah,
they tend to forget what it's like to be a student learning to thermal.
Sure.
So they won't necessarily be the kindest people to thermal with.
Yeah.
So you just have to be aware that they might be a bit more aggressive than you're used to, like other K-13s and K-14s being.
Somebody further out over there. I just got a little glint of a wing.
Yeah.
He's out in the mist somewhere. It's hard to see.
Okay, I didn't see that.
Yeah, he's a way off, I think. But sharky looking thing, it's right down below us at Mo.
Yep.
I think it was the one that was parked up as we were driving out.
I'll
there he is, okay.
That's what the second level fire warning is.
Yep. Yeah, that guy down underneath is there, the orange one.
That's a Focus 4.
Is it?
Yeah. It's only just finished being restored.
Yeah.
So it's not been
airworthy
very much.
Okay. Yeah, that guy's sort of hanging out on my tail here at the moment. Okay. He's going past. Yeah, it looks like he's heading off.
Yeah.
You think thinks better of what I'm in.
The focus ball is the sort of thing that was winning competitions back in like the 1950s.
Yeah. It's an interesting looking thing. You can kind of tell it's traditional construction, but very, very pointy looking.
Yeah. I think it's Polish.
Right.
I wouldn't swear to that. It's definitely not German like most guys.
Yeah, so. Yeah. The visibility's getting a bit rubbish, isn't it?
Yeah.
21 underneath this again.
We're broken through 3,000.
Yeah, we've got, I'm showing 200 here. That's nice. The haze like this, do you actually start to be worried about the visibility? Because I mean, I can actually see the ground a good way off, but equally, it's, I noticed well, it's kind of hard, one of the gliders is hard to spot until I got a reflection of its wing.
Well, okay, officially, the law, you know about the difference between VFR and IFR?
Yeah.
Yes, you've got obviously visual flight rules, instrument flight rules, and you've got a very similar concept in weather known as VMC-IMC.
Right.
So VMC is visual meteorological conditions, and IMC is instrument meteorological conditions. And you can only fly VFR like we're doing in VMC.
Yeah.
Whereas you can fly IFR in either one. So there's defined weather limits for what actually defines VMC. And one of the things is visibility. And the visibility required is different depending on whether you're below 3,000 feet, between 3 and 10, or above 10.
Right.
If you're above 10,000 feet, you require a visibility of 8 kilometres.
Right.
If you're above 3,000 feet, you require... Oh, sorry, if you're above 3,000 feet and you're travelling over 250 knots, you require 5 kilometres. If you're above 3,000 feet or below 3,000 feet and you're travelling less than 250 knots, then you only require a visibility of 3 kilometres.
Yeah.
Which I reckon we have. I think we've probably got 5 kilometres as well, actually.
Yeah.
Possibly not 8. Maybe just about 8. I'm not convinced we have 8, but...
No.
The other requirements, below 3,000 feet, you just have to be clear of clouds.
Sure.
Sight of the ground, and above 3,000 feet, you are supposed to be 1,000 metres horizontally clear of clouds and 1,000 feet vertically clear.
Right.
Generally, it's accepted that gliders are exempted from the 1,000 metres and 1,000 foot bit of that.
But sure.
We're still supposed to comply with the visibility. The one thing that you have to be aware of is power pilots who don't fly gliders as well often imagine that gliders will only fly in like perfect weather. When in reality, we'll often fly in worse weather than they will.
Right.
For example, when we were windsurfing into 900 feet.
Yeah, indeed.
Those power pilots wouldn't have taken off.
Yeah.
So quite often they will sort of be flying around the area, obviously lash them on the chart, and think, oh, the weather's crap, so there's no way they'll be
those
flying.
Those guys won't be here.
In actual fact, we are. So you have to be aware in lower visibility, stuff like this, that any power pilots in the area will quite possibly be under the impression that we're not flying.
Yeah.
Because they don't really understand the glide, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm trying to crib what he was up to, and then he gave up on it at about the same time.
Yeah. I would be thinking twice about maybe going cross country in this.
Yeah, it is a bit murky, isn't it? Let's see if we can pick anything up this way.
One thing you'll notice if you ever check your phone while flying, when you go through roughly 3,000 feet, you'll suddenly lose all phone signal.
Right.
It doesn't make much sense because the way that obviously radio waves work, you think a higher up,
you think, yeah.
The reason for it is because in the UK, the Telecommunications Act means that phone companies are required to block phone signal above 3,000 feet.
Okay. So it's a deliberate.
So yeah, you lose all your signal when you get them up through.
Yeah.
Whereas in Australia, where they don't have that, at 10,000 feet, it absolutely perfect.
Yeah. How funny.
But I didn't try it, but I'm pretty sure I could have streamed Netflix.
Well, I'm going to try another direction here. Get some speed going. So that that guy down there was exploring as well, and I think didn't find a lot, but he's now making his way back again. Got him straight ahead of me now. Yeah.
Yes.
And then another crossing the field, and another one literally on my nose, but a long way off. Now I'm gonna turn right here because I've got a faint hint of something going on, and it also means that I'll then be doing something predictable for him to look at.
Yep.
Not that there's much doing there, but. To be honest, he looks like he might have something himself. As we're below now, let's see how we time this. If he's continuing round, I'll go and join in underneath. Okay. But it looks like he's rising relative to us at least. It might just be that we're sinking and he isn't, but... Definitely something going on here. Now, Am I?
There's something there, but I'm not convinced the K21's actually in it.
No, something is happening. So he's coming in behind me, and I'm gonna turn and try and get round a bit tighter so that we don't end up with him just on our tail. I'm not sure that I'm actually in the good bit there, because he's now climbing past us. See if the orange guy is better centred on it.
Yep.
A big lump of some sort.
Like that, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it's a nice reference point, that one. Lumpy just there. He's kind of they're turning inside each other a bit there.
It's not too much of a problem.
Is that all right with the height separation?
Yeah. It only starts to matter if we're very, very
got our 3,000 back again, which is nice.
Yep.
Getting slightly more comfortable keeping it a little slower in the turn. It will get a little bit more tricky to keep the speed constant as I try and keep it slower. It's just me, I think. Getting comfortable.
Doing nicely, regardless of how high this lift goes, we have to stop climbing at 4,500 feet.
Because
at 4,800 feet, there is London's Class A airspace.
Sure.
And terminal maneuvering area. And if we were to enter that, I would be in a massive amount of trouble.
Yep.
So we're absolutely not going
to. So definitely that. Not even close to that. Yeah.
No, we're going to stop at
we'll 4 stop short.
If we get to 4-5.
Yeah, if we get that even. To be honest, the visibility is getting decidedly. I'm in amongst the edge of a cloud there, to be honest.
Yeah.
Shall I go? Let's head north a bit.
Let's do that, yeah.
Actually, I'm not convinced that I'm coming out of it at all there. Let's just come out this way. And there goes the, yeah, we're kind of flying into more of it. Got the 21 coming in underneath us, ahead of us. Just crossing paths. Was that his beep, I presume?
Probably.
Yeah.
I can't actually see the case.
Yeah, he's literally right under.
Yeah. I have less visibility than
yeah,
our wings.
Yeah. Yeah, we're in amongst a few puffy bits here, aren't we?
Yep.
A little correction that way, see what's going on. Well, as we're in clearer air, that tiny lump I might just go back to, see if there's anything around it. Having been somewhat, at least in a bit where we're not suffering with visibility.
Quite a bit colder up here.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? Yeah, it's noticeable.
Temperature reduction is roughly 3 degrees per 1,000 feet.
Uh-huh.
So when we're nearly 4,000 feet up, that's about 12 degrees colder than it is on the ground.
Yeah. We're doing a very broad turn at the moment just to see if anything happens. I'm feeling maybe the good stuff was underneath the bit where we can't see, basically. But, come on. It's pretty much going to be back in the military bit again, isn't it, basically?
Yeah. About 4,000 feet, or the, between 3 and 4,000 feet is not a reasonable power base in the UK for a country flying.
Yeah.
If you get any more than 4,000, it's not a good thing. Contrast that with Australia, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Hey, the fire truck's out again.
Oh yeah.
So just keep an eye on what they're doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just in case we have to land through the jet movement.
Yeah. rider ahead of us there, just because of the barb over the into the cloudy stuff. There it is, yeah. Fairly conspicuous size, isn't it?
Yep.
Obviously the thing you have to be aware of is if you get ahead of jet arriving.
Yeah.
It's supposed to go around.
Yeah, indeed.
We're currently up the extended center.
Yes, yes.
You see that big fancy house down to the right of the snow?
That one there, yeah.
Yeah, the swimming pool that's left of it. Where the turn point Lash and West is.
Okay. Centered. Yeah.
So when cross country aircraft are coming back from the west, that's going to be important. They're final turn point.
Got you.
Before heading into the
Yeah. It's all on very sinky just here. Let's go under a cloud, not least for the shade.
Yeah.
I'll just see if this edge of it is any better than coming out of the edge. Looks like a long way away. It looks like I want to go home at this point.
Okay. You can use a very similar technique to sort of roughly figure out whether you're on glide to Lasham or not.
Yeah.
You use for approach control.
Yeah.
Put it in your canopy.
Yeah.
Appearing under the nose, then you're making it back with a reasonable amount of height. If it's staying still in your canopy, then you're pretty much going to arrive at ground level.
Yeah.
And if it's disappearing under, sorry, if it's moving up your canopy,
moving up the canopy,
then
yeah,
you're currently
then
undershooting
bad things.
And need to climb.
Yeah.
It's very rough. It doesn't work as precisely as approach control.
No, no.
But, still sort of open up though.
Well, let's split the difference. There's more cloud and more, you know, we found a little bit of lift back that way, so let's take ourselves a bit closer. We're in actually fairly buoyant air in a straight line here, aren't we?
Yep.
Had something there, but clearly not. Don't let the nose get in the way. Yeah, I was going to say, we've done Stirling.
So if we aim back in an airfieldy sort of direction now.
Yeah, indeed.
And we'll practice some steep turns down into the circuit.
Okay. Sitting there at the end for a while, hasn't he? Looks like he's just kind of being tugged round.
Yeah.
So, glider-wise, I have probably a K21 straight ahead, about 11 o'clock actually.
Okay.
Just look fairly below us. Don't see anybody else particularly at the moment. Where should we go to do the steeper turns? Obviously we've still got some height here, but...
we'll just sort of hang around near the beginning of the circuit, so that we're ready to start the circuit when we get down to that sort of height.
Yeah, indeed. So essentially, once we get kind of past these the brown fields that we've got here, somewhere over there.
I think pretty much here will be all right to be honest, I think. Okay. So
fair enough.
You might go to the left first.
Okay. So just literally just into a fairly...
Yep.
I want to be more like 50 knots into that.
Remember, the amount of rudder you're using is proportional to the amount of stick.
Yeah.
So if you're doing a lot of sticking, you're going to need a lot of rudder as well.
Yeah. You have control.
I'm going to show you a steep turn reversal.
Yeah.
I'm going into a right turn to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So just like a nice and steep right hand turn, okay?
Yeah.
And all I'm going to do is I'm going to roll back to the left.
Okay.
And what you're going to find if I roll to the left, I'm going to need loads of rudder. I'm also going to need to relax on and then re-add the back pressure.
Sure, okay? Okay. So otherwise we're going to go nose high through it, aren't we?
So this is what it should look like.
Okay.
So, rolling left, lots of rudder, relaxing off the back pressure. I've got the K8, re-adding the back pressure. If you do it wrong, it looks more like this, okay?
Okay, okay.
And the nose comes flying up, and we've actually stalled.
Yeah, okay.
Back. Okay, make sense?
Yeah, okay.
Control. You have control.
Okay, I have control. So, let's go left first then.
Yep. So make sure you're happy with your left turn before you start the reversal, okay? So we'll go for it whenever you're ready.
Yeah. Try and get that stabilised a bit better, so one thing or the other.
That wasn't too bad. Yeah. Okay, so try reversing it back to the left again.
Yeah, okay, so.
Remember, even though you're applying lots of rudder when you're rolling, you still don't need very much when you're in.
Once you're into it, yeah, exactly. Okay. I held in more than I needed there. My spring was pointing in funny places.
Okay, let's go back to the right again.
Okay.
That was nice. And let's do one more back to the left.
Yeah, okay.
There we go. Feeling a bit better now?
Yeah.
Good.
A bit better about that.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. Awesome. Whenever you think it's right, start the circuit. Just bear in mind, because of the place we're flying the circuit to, obviously the equivalent runway distance to a flying is actually shorter than the main runway. So it's as if we're flying to a shorter runway.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. Got a little bit more height than I really need right now.
Yep, do you know
so, it's a good point. I've lost him for the moment.
11 o'clock. Low.
Got him? Low.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I see him. Yeah, okay. That's cool. And of course, I'm hitting lift on the way.
Yep, of course.
Of course. So I might just spend a circuit, a little twirl to. Oh, of course, I'm going to hit like all the lift there ever was. Yeah. Cheers. There's me thinking, yeah, I'll waste 100 feet.
And you just gained 100
feet. Literally gained 100 feet.
Should we go back and start the circuit again?
Yeah. Because I'm halfway down there and all I did was, was gain.
I was turning around.
Yeah, let's go again. The opportunity to be firmer with the controls as we were just doing in that same way.
Yep.
Limiting factor is very much my legs getting in the way of the stick there.
Yeah.
We've gained another 100 feet, obviously. Scratching around earlier on trying to make it work, and now we can't not make it work.
Okay. If it absolutely comes to it, you still want the effort.
Well, yeah, exactly. Seems rude to to waste.
It does, yeah.
But yes. So I'll make a turn to the left in a minute and lock some locks. We've got a bit of sink there that now feels slightly more appropriate, and it is, just to be clear, it's south of the launch vehicle area, so that lighter piece of grass,
you
whole area
don't need
there.
To go a long way into the landing area.
No.
You can still land it sort of just the other side of the perimeter track.
Yeah, okay. Nobody on the circuit the other side. downwind leg lift just to help us out.
Yeah.
Get my speed trimmed out for a bit faster again now that we're approaching my 45. I'm kind of stretching things out a bit here as we're still high. Yep. And I'm using 45 there.
One thing you might find is when you spend a while up at 4,000 feet,
yeah,
your depth perception of low down sort of changes a bit.
Sure, yeah. Warm.